Oh, you are saying that
the video will be in the past.
Okay, so good afternoon. Let us get today's colloquium going. Firstly, those of you who are wondering why we have assembled in auditorium, due to some administrative reasons, we had to organize this in the auditorium rather than the usual AG66. If there is any inconvenience caused, we are sorry for that. It gives great pleasure to Asset and also the TIFR on behalf of the director TIFR. It's great pleasure to welcome today's speaker, Sheng-Lung Huang, who is from Department of Electrical Engineering, National Taiwan University, who is going to deliver today's colloquium. And before I formally introduce today's speaker, I would like to thank the IEEE Photonics, Bombay Section Photonics Society, which is co-organizing this event. In fact, we have the office bearers of the society, Dr. Roshan Makkar, who is the chair of the Bombay Section Photonics Society. We also have our own Aditya Dharmadkar, who is the vice chair of Photonics Society of Bombay Section. For those of you, I'm sure all of you are aware, IEEE is the world's largest professional body with about 420,000 members spread all over the world. And it runs most of the major technical activities and programs through its what is called chapters and societies, which are actually the blood and bone of, let us say, IEEE. There are 39 such societies, and Photonics Society is one of those. And we are very grateful to the society for co-organizing this event today at TIFR. Now, going back and formally introducing today's speaker, Dr. Huang received his PhD from the Department of Electrical Engineering, University of Maryland in 1993. He is a distinguished professor at the Graduate Institute of Photonics and Optoelectronics. It's called GIPO, and the Department of Electrical Engineering at National Taiwan University. He served as chairman of GIPO from 2007 to 2010. He was also a guest professor at the Abbey School of Photonics, Frederick Schiller University of Jena, Germany in 2014. Dr. Huang is a fellow of the Optica. He pioneers the development of cellular resolution, optical coherence tomography, and I'm sure he's going to talk about extensively today, and has used it clinically in the early stage diagnosis of cancers and such diseases. In 2014, he co-founded Apollo Medical Optics and was the chief technology officer. Dr. Huang served as the chairperson of IEEE LEOS, now which is IEEE PS, Taipei chapter from 2005 to 2006. He was a steering board member of the European Masters of Science in Photonics. Dr. Huang served as an associate editor of the IEEE Photonics Journal and was a topical editor of Optics Letters from 2005 to 2011. Those of you, again, who are sort of not familiar, the IEEE publishes large number of very, very high impact journals, and the transactions, IEEE transactions, are known to be highest level of, in terms of impact factor and other metrics. Dr. Huang has received the Outstanding Research Award from the Ministry of Science and Technology and the University/Industry Cooperation Award from the Ministry of Education, Taiwan. He has also received Chimai Innovation Excellence Award and Optical Communication Elite Award. So it's indeed great pleasure to invite such a distinguished speaker among us, who is going to kind of talk today on deep learning empowered optical coherence tomography. Now it's over to Dr. Huang.
So can you hear me? Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sadia for the introduction. And I also would like to thank him and Dr. Roshan for putting together this program. Yeah, it's really very nice to have a chance to visit TIFR today. And so this talk is about optical coherence tomography. It was invented about 30 years ago. Right now, it has been widely deployed in many hospitals, medical centers, and benefit millions of people these days. So I hope this talk can give the audience an idea about the present status of OCT and the future trend, and how we can apply the artificial intelligence on OCT to empower this technology for clinical diagnosis. And down here, these are my collaborators. This is NTU, my university hospital. This is Mackay Memorial Hospital, which is located in Taiwan. And this is Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. These are my medical collaborators. And about 9 years ago, I co-founded a company called Apollo Medical Optics, because for any clinical trial, you not just have an instrument, the instrument has to be approved by the regulation agency. For example, the FDA in India, I believe you have a similar regulatory institutes. And this one is the AI NTU. For this center, actually, because in Taiwan, our government start to realize that AI is something very important. So the government putting a lot of resources I think starting from year about 2018, so they put in resource fundings and also build up the infrastructure, because for these days, when we talk about the AI, people are referred to the deep learning. For deep learning, you need a very huge computation resources. Yeah, so the government tried to promote this technology. And starting from 2 years ago, they feel that, well, we also need to have outreach, try to have more international collaborations with worldwide agencies. So right now in Taiwan, we have four major AI related research center. This is the Taiwan Island. So my university is at the northern part, it's National Taiwan University. We also have three other national centers for AI studies. So right now we have 400 experts worldwide joining force to develop the AI. And we have more than 4,000 graduate students to take part in this program. And right now, actually in Taiwan, for the many of the industry, you know, Taiwan is quite famous for information and the communication technologies. And starting from 5 to 6 years ago, many of those ICT companies, they also try to have kind of a paradigm shift to from ICT, from technology to really the application. When I say application, it's mainly the precision health. So I think many of the companies here, you probably heard about the TSMC, this is for foundry service. I think this one is a Foxconn. I believe Foxconn should have some factories in India. And some other like HTC, this is for cell phone, Acer for the notebook. Yeah, I think actually right now, I believe the majority of the ICT companies, yeah, they have some kind of work on toward the future precision health using the technology for biomedical components, devices, mobile devices, and in the future, they want to integrate all these precision health device component device system in hospital for offer new hospital solutions. Now, for those of you who are not quite familiar with Taiwan, I can also give a very brief introduction about Taiwan, because Taiwan, you know, is a very small island. But even it's a small island, but actually right now in Taiwan we have about 160. Universities in Taiwan. So you can see different colors here represent different cities, and the number here means how many universities are within the city. So overall, right now, among these 160 universities, 35 of them that have a dedicated photonics program, either for the undergraduate program or master or for the PhD program. So because we have so rich in photonics manpowers, so you can imagine, so these days, Taiwan contribute about 11% of a total worldwide photonics market share, okay. Now a little bit about my university. I'm with the National Taiwan University. And as I mentioned, our main campus is located at upper part of the Taipei city, but actually in Taiwan we have about 16 campus throughout the Taiwan island, and the number of students we have is about 33,000 students. And in Taiwan, the highest mountain is at the center part of Taiwan, which is called Jade Mountain. The height is about almost 4,000 meters, and the summit of the mountain actually belongs to NTU. Okay. So the overall campus real estate of NTU covers 1% of the Taiwan island. Yeah. Okay, now let's move on to the main topic for today's talk. So I will give a very brief overview about AI on biomedical imaging, and briefly show you our cellular resolution OCT technologies. Then I will share with you our recent progress, how we apply AI on our imaging for disease diagnosis. Then eventually we hope that, because OCT is kind of imaging modality, eventually actually many people consider the holy grail of OCT is that one day it could be possible to replace the so-called excisional biopsy, because for excision biopsy, you really have a excisional operation. But for OCT, this is kind of optical technology, or you can call this a virtual biopsy. The only issue is that because for biomedical field, it's quite conservative, and the histopathology has been there for long. Okay, so you need to accumulate a lot of evidence. So in the future, we hope that people can believe that using the OCT, you really can realize the so-called virtual biopsy. Okay, now, because the AI is not something, it's not a new term. So starting from year 1950s, people talk about AI. So today, this is year 2023, is more than 70 years. But over these years, we know that there are a lot of progress has been made on AI. And very recently, people talk about deep learning. I think the major difference of deep learning compared to the earlier version, people call this machine learning, is that if you look at the figure on the upper right-hand side, the horizontal axis is the amount of data. Okay, the vertical axis is about the performance of AI. As you can see here, if you use the traditional machine learning, when the data set becomes very large, the performance is kind of saturated. But in case you use deep learning, the performance can keep on increasing linearly. So which means that the bigger the data set, then the better the performance. And the good thing for many biomedical technology is that it's the data acquisition rate is very fast. So for example, for OCT, just in 1 second, you can accumulate many gigabytes of data. So you can imagine it's very quick, you can accumulate the data. So which kind of a perfect match to the recent deep learning algorithms. Okay, we have big data, so we can have better performance. So you can see that over the years, in many different specialty of the medical field, either on the central nerve system, breast, abdomen, and other topics, the publication is kind of exponentially grows. Assume from this view graph, you can see that the horizontal axis is the number of papers. So these days people focus on pathology, because when you talk about pathology, usually, for example, for cancer diagnosis, you need a very high resolution. You got to be able to see the cell clearly, because either the size of the nuclei, the shape of the nuclei, the density of the nuclei, they are also, those are very important information for physicians or clinicians to make a decision whether the cell is a normal cell or is a cancerous cell. So for pathology-based application, usually you need a high resolution. And also for the brain, as you can see here, it's also a very hot area, because for brain, it's very rich in okay. So, and these days people, they are getting to have more evidence to show that the nerve has a very close relationship to many different diseases. For example, for the Parkinson's disease, diabetes type 2, okay, the nerve, the length of the nerve, the number of branches of the nerve, the tortuosity of the nerve, all those things are related to the status of those diseases. Okay, and today we are talking about the OCT, so I will show you how we use OCT. I think the main application in my group, but we hope that in the future, you can really just use the OCT for cancer diagnosis, okay? And the OCT technology actually is quite simple. For example, you can see this is the tissue to be tested. You have an incident light on the tissue, then you just try to detect your backscatter light, okay? The only issue is that the backscatter light is pretty weak. Okay, so you want to have a very sensitive technology to detect this backscatter light. So we use this is kind of interferometry. You have a light source here, you have a beam splitter, you have a reference on. This is a device on the test. So you combine the reference and the light from the device, so you can try to generate imagings. And as you can see here, there's such a configuration, just like a conventional Michelson interferometer, right? The only difference is that usually for a microstrain interferometer, you use a laser, for example, the Hini laser as a light source. But for OCT, you prefer to use an incoherent light source. Actually, the broader the light source bandwidth, the better the resolution you can achieve. So as you can see here, the broader the light source bandwidth and the better the resolution you can have. And for such a interferometric detection scheme, actually it's very sensitive, just like in optical communication. You know, in optical communication, because your signal need to transmit over a very long distance. So you need a very high sensitivity detection scheme. So this is very similar to the homodyne detection, okay? So because this detection scheme is very sensitive, so you can use a pretty low optical power, then you can have enough signal to noise ratio to generate the imagings. So as you can see here, so in case everything is fixed, you just scan this reference arm, you can have this 1D signal, we call this A scan. So you see several peaks here, each peak represent that there's a interface between with the index of refraction change, okay? So you see this kind of A scan. So in case your sample, you have a one-dimensional movement, then you can generate a 2D imaging. This is a human cornea. Then in case your sample, you have a two-dimensional movement, or you try to scan your instant beam, then you can have this kind of a three-dimensional imaging. This is a video. Okay, actually this video shows a human hair follicle. So at different time, it shows actually the signal from different depths, okay? So OCT can give you this kind of 3D tomography. And because OCT, the data acquisition rate is very high. So you can either generate this kind of 3D imaging, or you can use the temporal data. For example, do signal processing, so you can add in more information on the 2D imaging, okay? Depends on, for example, especially for in vivo sample, you have a blood flow, you have breath, you have eye blink, so you can add in information on the 2D to give you a colorful imaging. And these days, because OCT was invented, I mentioned about 30 years ago, so right now, worldwide, I think at least there are more than 100 OCT companies. Roughly about 80% of them are using OCT on ophthalmology. So you can use OCT to probe the retina. You can see that for the retina, there are roughly about 10 layers of structure. So using OCT, you can see the layer. So whether the thickness of the layer is normal. And these days, if you use a longer wavelength, you can even see the choroid, okay? So using the OCT, people can diagnose it, such as the age-related macular degradation. Also for the anterior segment, okay, people use the OCT to detect the narrow angle, glaucoma, and several eye-related diseases. Another very popular OCT application is on cardiology, okay? So for this application, you need a kind of a fiber probe, okay, to stick protrude into your vessel, to your heart. So you can imaging the inner wall of the coronary vessel, okay? So, and for cardiology, there are also many possible applications. For example, you can make an assessment whether the plaque is vulnerable or is not vulnerable. Or some people, especially for senior citizens, many times you have insert stent within your coronary vessel. Whether the stent is installed well or not, you can use the OCT to make an evaluation. And right now the OCT market size, I think starting from 2 years ago, is already 1.4 billion. And the application areas, ophthalmology, cardiology, and very recently people start to care about oncology and dermatology. So in the future, what's the trend you can see from here? Remember I mentioned OCT was invented 30 years ago by Professor James Fujimoto at MIT. And at that time, people work on mainly on ophthalmology and cardiovascular imaging. At that time, people mainly care about the imaging speed, okay? Because the advantage of OCT is for in vivo application. So the imaging speed has to be very fast, okay? Because you breath, you have blood flow. And starting from maybe 10 years ago, people start to care not just the imaging speed, people also care about resolution. If you have better resolution, then you can do cancer diagnosis, or you can probe the nerve, length, density, tortuosity kind of parameters. So in either of these application area, you can see that in the past few years, they are growing very fast. Okay, and in my group, actually, we are, remember I mentioned for OCT, you prefer to have broadband light sources. So in my laboratory, we use a so-called crystalline fiber source. You can generate either in the visible wavelength range or near infrared. The center wavelength here is about 800 nanometer or longer near infrared wavelength. So for different center wavelengths, you can have different applications. For example, in my laboratory, before we have collaborated with LCD companies because using the visible light, you can penetrate your LCD panel to detect the color filter, the liquid crystal orientation kind of thing. Using this near infrared light, you can, it's very helpful for ophthalmology and the dermatology applications. And for the longer wavelengths, usually the longer the center wavelength, the deeper the penetration into the tissue. Because OCT is a kind of optical technology. So usually the general feeling about optical technology is that even though it's possible to have high resolution, but the penetration is low, okay? But using a longer wavelength, it's possible to have a longer penetration. Okay, so this view graph gives you an idea about using our crystal fiber light sources on human skin. So you can see for this video shows the end phase, which means that at different time, the image comes from different depths of the human tissue. This is a cross section. We can call this B scan. Okay, so you see many these black areas. Those are the nuclei of the human skin. We have compared with the HG stain imaging to prove that those areas. And because OCT, as I mentioned, the imaging speed is very fast. So you can see that we can even see the, this is a red blood cell flowing within the micro vessels, okay? So you can have some micrometer resolution. And also the good thing is that the power is very low because if you want to apply the any technology on human body, you got to be safe, okay? So the power is less than 3 milliwatt. You know, for a typical rear pointer, the power is more than 5 milliwatt. In case the power is less than 5 milliwatt, you see the rear laser is not strong enough. So the OCT power is even lower than the rear pointer. Okay, so this view graph, just to try to amuse the audience here, we have different students in my group. So this is one of my Indian students. You can see that. So the penetration depth actually is shallower compared to Taiwanese students. And for my Spanish student, the penetration depth is even deeper. So in this case, the penetration depth down to here is about 400 micrometer. So even though just 400 micrometer is pretty shallow, but the key issue, the key location that physicians want to see is actually the junction between epidermis and dermis, okay? So for example, in this case, the line here, this is the we call DJ, dermal epidermal junction, because most of the skin related diseases is originated from this DJ for the cancer or many other diseases. Okay, so the penetration depth of OCT on skin actually, in the one hand, it depends on the wavelength. The longer the wavelength, the deeper the penetration, or depends on the human races, because for Indian people, probably have more melanin, because melanin has some absorption. So the penetration depth is a little bit shallower. And apparently this technology is good for ophthalmology applications. So for this one, we use our OCT on the cornea. So this is the superficial layer. So different sub-figures here represent different depths of the OCT imaging. This is a superficial layer, wing layer, basal layer, and to the stroma, And this is, I believe, this is the Bowman layer. And then you can see, I don't know whether you can see this, there are kind of dendritic patterns here. Those dendrite actually is the nerve, okay? So remember, I just mentioned the density of the nerve, the length of the nerve, the number of branches of the nerve, all related to many diseases. Okay, then in case you want to apply this OCT in the future for cancer diagnosis, you got to compare with the so-called gold standard. Because right now the gold standard in hospital for physicians, when they try to make a diagnosis, whether the tissue is a normal tissue or is a benign tissue or is a malignant tissue, they use this the so-called HE step, hemotoxylin and the eosine skin. You can see here, there are two colors. One is the purple, one is the pink. The purple usually represent the nuclei. The pink represent the cytoplasma. So on the right-hand side, this is the OCT, okay? So even though the OCT, apparently this is a black and white imaging, okay? But if you look at the detailed structure, for example, you have a hair follicle here from OCT, you can also see similar structure. You have a fat cell here, you can see something here. Okay, and this is a very high resolution imaging. And for this one, this is a very large area. Okay, so in terms of resolution, I think for OCT, there's no problem. You can see, you can have submicrometer resolution. But in terms of specificity or the contrast of the imaging, apparently you can see usually the HE is better because at least you have two colors. You have the purple and the pink, okay? But for OCT, you only have black and white, okay? So in the future, actually, we also try to apply deep learning. So to see whether we add in, with the support of deep learning, we can translate this kind of black and white imaging into this kind of colorful stand imaging. And right now, worldwide, actually, the health expenditure is escalating very fast in the past years. So this is data from United States as an example. You can see that the overall about 15 to 20% of their GDP was spent on health expenditure. So you can see it's more than $4 trillion. So for different country, the ratio may not be different, but usually from 10 to 20% is quite popular. So you can imagine, so it's something very urgent or important in the future that we can control the health expenditure. It's better, you can of course reduce. I think the key issue is that in case you can have early diagnosis of diseases, okay? Usually for many or for most of the diseases, in case you can detect in the early stage, it's very easy, you can cure the disease even without a surgery. But in case you find out your cancer in the late stage, even though you spend a lot of funding, a lot of money, you have a lot of operations, still it may not be useful, okay? So I think OCT is a technology that really has the chance to detect diseases in the early stage. Why? Because if you look at this this figure here, the horizontal axis is the severity of a diseases, okay? And usually for the function change, it's kind of a stepwise. For example, in the one day, you feel that you can see things very clear. In the second day, you feel that, well, the imaging seems to be become blur, okay? Because our perception, you know, is not that linear. So usually the functional change, or you feel you have a toothache, okay? You feel that yesterday it's fine, but today it become, you have very strong toothache, okay? So this kind of functional change usually is a kind of step over time. But for OCT, we detect the structure, okay? So the larger the structure change, then you can see the more severity. So it's a kind of linear dependence. So as you can see here, so even before the functional change, using OCT, you already see the structural change. Okay, so you do have a good chance to have early diagnosis of many diseases. Okay, so with OCT, I think in the one hand, as I mentioned, you can detect the structure of the diseases. For example, the cellular information, like whether the cell is under a necrosis process or apoptosis process, or whether the cell to cell any interaction. For those things, you just need a high resolution OCT. And because OCT is a very broadband technology, so you have the spectral information. And also because it's very fast, so you can have dynamic information. So with the integration of dynamic OCT or spectroscopy OCT, you can have more activation pathway or system coordination information. And these days, if you can even adding the artificial intelligence, we believe if you can really integrate all this technology, then in the future, you have a good chance to have detect diseases in the early stage. And the good thing is that right now, they'll start to have some example. For example, applying AI to empower OCT. Right now, there's already have a commercial product that have passed the, it was approved by the United States FDA. You know, the DeepMind is a company which was established in United Kingdom. And later on, it was acquired by Google, okay? So with the Google, so they have a lot of physicians help to label the imaging or annotate the imaging. Because for these days, for deep learning, in the one hand, you need a very big data set, okay? On the other hand, you also need a high quality labeling or annotation on your imaging, okay? So when you have a large data set, you have a lot of high quality annotation, then it's very helpful for training the computer network for accurate diagnosis. So as you can see here on the left column, this is a raw OCT black and white imagings. In the center column is a physician's annotation, and the right-hand side is a prediction. Okay, you can see that the predict result is quite match with this annotation quite well. And also using the AI, you can find out within such an imaging, where is the hotspot. Hotspot means that this is the region that contribute to the these are the major image pixels that contribute to the AI to make a decision whether this is a normal cell or this is a cancer cell, or whether there are many different kind of segmentation targets. So using the AI, it can also tell you identify where is the most important portion that physicians got to pay attention. Okay, so that's a very brief overview about the AI on biomedical imaging. Now let me share with you our recent progress using the deep learning on our cellular resolution OCT. We start from an animal model. Okay, so this is a collaboration with our university hospital. So we starting from a live mouse. So we try to apply some chemicals on the mouse skin. So starting from the mouse skin is under the normal state. And after 1 or 2 weeks, the mouse skin become, we call dysplasia status. Then after maybe 6 weeks, then there you can see there are tumors. These are actually malignant tumor. We call this squamous cell carcinoma, okay. So basically, for this mouse skin, we have the normal mouse skin, dysplasia, and SCC. And because the imaging speed is very fast, so right now we have about 1.5 terabyte of imaging. So this is really a big data set, okay? Now, just the data set is not enough. You need the annotation. So we biopsy the sample, and we have using the apply the H&E stain. So this information serves as the ground truth, okay? Because using the H&E stain, right now, remember I mentioned this is kind of gold standard for physicians to determine whether this is cancer or not. So with the big data and with the annotation, so we want to see whether after training of the network, whether the computer the AI can make a high accuracy to classify these three states. Okay, so the vertical axis actually show the accuracy. So you can see that it's quite easy. We can have this tenfold cross validation. We can have more than 90%. And many physicians ask me that whether this high accuracy is related to high accuracy, the high resolution of the OCT. So we purposely try to reduce the imaging quality. So the horizontal axis, we kind of downsampling the imaging. So starting from a very high resolution imaging here, we try to downsample, so it become blurred imaging. As you can see here, the more you reduce the resolution and also the accuracy kind of decreasing linearly. So you do need a higher resolution so you can have higher classification accuracy. And some people then ask that, well, it seems that AI works, it gives you pretty good result, but the AI is, you know, it's a lot of metrics manipulation, just like a black box. And then people have no idea how the AI after training, they can tell you whether this is a normal skin or this is a cancer skin. Fortunately, these days worldwide, there are so many groups, they're working on many different tools to help people to visualize how the AI make a decision. So this is the tool we use called GradCam, okay? So remember I mentioned we have three different kinds of tissues. One is a normal tissue, one is a dysplasia tissue, and one is a cancer tissue, okay? And on the vertical axis, these are, we call this a heat map, okay? The, for example, if you see this red color, that means these are the important pixels that help the AI to make a decision, okay? For this heat map one, means that the AI is looking at a small, with a smaller receptive field, or you look at more detail of the imaging. For the heat map four, we use a lower resolution, so the AI is a focus on a larger area of the tissue. As you can see here, for the heat map one, for those tiny bright spots, which means that these spots are the very important pixels that help the AI to make a decision. And these bright spots match very well with the nuclei within the OCT imaging, which means, because for a physician, we talk to many physicians, when they look at this kind of either HE stain imaging or this OCT, what are they looking for? Most of the dermatologists told me that the first thing they want to identify, where is the DJ, dermal epidermal junction, that's the first thing. After they identify the DJ, the next thing is they want to see it's a nuclei, whether the nuclei density is high or low, what's the size of the nuclei, or the cytoplasma ratio, that kind of information. So as you can see here, for the AI, you also care about the nuclei. That's why all these bright spot matches very well with the nuclei location. And for larger scale, as you can see here, these bright lines, actually this is the DJ of the image. These are DJ, these are the DJ. So as you can see here, the AI can make a pretty good prediction. The information, the AI care actually match quite well with the physicians. Both of them care about the nuclei, care about the layer structure of the human skin. So with this, we have more confidence to proceed because the earlier experiment is a mouse experiment. So, and after we publish our paper, we attract the attention of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, because in the United States, you know, skin cancer is something very significant. Each year, there are more than two to three million new incidents of skin cancer, okay? But I think in Taiwan or in India, probably you guys don't care about skin cancer, but for the in the American, Europe, or even Australia, people are just, there's a very famous skin cancer operation called Mohs surgery, okay? Because many times the skin cancer is on the human face, okay? So in case the cancer is on your hand, it's very easy. You just use a knife, you can cut out this tumor region, is okay. But in case the lesion is on your face, you try to minimize the amount of excisional volume, right? So the most surgery, basically, they try to slice off the tumor one thin slice at a time. After one slice, they try to check whether the malignant tumor is totally removed. In case yes, then it's done. In case not, they just make another slice, okay? Slice by slice, okay? So we have a collaboration to see whether we can just use OCT imaging to make a diagnosis. So for the patients in the MSKCC, basically they will have an excisional biopsy, so they can have a stent imaging. They also take an OCT imaging. And based on these two imaging, the pathologists, they can try to segment where is the boundary of the skin cancer. In this case, this is a so-called basal cell carcinoma. Okay, this is the most popular skin cancer. So you can see this red line just shows the boundary of the BCC, and the green line, I don't know whether you can see the green line, it shows the segment, the hair follicle, and the orange line is the sebaceous gland. Okay, so from this stain imaging, and also when the physician, they look at this stain imaging, and so they can try to label this OCT imaging, also about the boundary of this lesions. Okay, so we basically roughly collect about 20 patients in New York. So this is our preliminary result. This is a test result, which means that the deep learning network haven't seen all these three imagings. Okay, and these are the annotation by the physicians, and these are the AI prediction. As you can see here, this is the annotation of the boundary of the basal cell carcinoma. Okay, so qualitatively speaking, you can see that the result is reasonable, and we do have some quantitative assessment. As you can see that the overall accuracy is almost 90%, okay? The sensitivity is good, it's 93%, but the specificity is a little bit low. But remember, for this result, it's based on only 20 patients. And also remember, for the deep learning, the larger the data set, the better you can have the performance, I believe, in the future. In case we could have a larger data set, I think we should be able to achieve more than 90% of accuracy. And that's an ex vivo. Then very recently, actually 2 or 3 years ago, we start to work on in vivo. So studies. So we collaborate with the MO. So they developed the instrument, which was approved by the FDA and the Taiwan FDA. Yeah. And from this system, actually, you can acquire either the 2D N-phase imaging or the cross-sectional imaging, also the three-dimensional imaging. So from this imaging, actually, you can identify where is the Sheldon conian, Sheldon granulosum, Sheldon spinosum, and also the DJ. This is the thermal epidermal junction, the microcapillary, the small vessel, or the papillary dermis. Here, this is a sweat duct. Even for some pigments, for example, the melanin, you see many bright spots here. Those are the melanin. Okay, so you can easily identify using this in vivo machine. So right now we have many clinical trials in Taiwan, either with the medical center or clinics. So I think right now it's about 10 medical centers in Taiwan, and also worldwide we have collaborated with three medical centers. One is the MSK at New York, and also we have one system at Berlin, and also one in Beijing for clinical trial. But so far, actually about 3 years ago, we tried to have a clinical trial to recruit 2,000 patients in Taiwan, but unfortunately due to the COVID, so you know, many physicians, many patients, they are reluctant to go to hospital. So after 2 years, we only collect about 200 patients using this in vivo system. So among these 200 patients, we have identified about 20 to 30 different skin-related diseases. So the physicians at the Mackay Memorial Cancer Center, so they try to prepare a kind of textbook, because for this kind of HE stain imaging, most of the physicians, they are very familiar with this kind of HE, because they try to study how to read this HE since they were medical school students. But for OCT, many of them never saw this kind of OCT before. So you do need a kind of a textbook, so they can compare, you know, when the HE stain, you have this HE stain, and how this OCT image may look like. And also, right now in Mackay Hospital, they general for each patient, they will take the so-called clinical imaging and the thermoscope imaging. So for each patient, for each lesion, we have this kind of four imagings, okay? And this is a BCC. And this EMPD is also a kind of a malignant tumor, okay? So we also have this kind of four imaging. So another possible, patients, they go to a hospital is for kind of cosmetic dermatology. For example, these days people try to use the picosecond laser or femtosecond laser on the human skin. Either you can use the laser to vaporize the pigment, the melanin. Okay, so you won't have this navy or dark skin. And sometimes you can use the picosecond or femtosecond laser to generate, we call this a light-induced optical breakdown. So use a laser to generate this kind of holes, okay? Holes underneath your skin. In the past, for those physicians, they only know that when they apply the picosecond laser, something was happened beneath the skin, but they have no idea what's the size of the LIOB or what's the depth. Using OCT, you can generate this kind of information. So right now for the Mackay Hospital, the physician, they have a kind of OCT atlas. And among here, there are about 20 different diseases. So for the newcomers, you just look at this book, then you can identify what kind of diseases. Okay, now remember I mentioned that for cancer diagnosis, it's, the nuclei information is something very important. The size of the nuclei, the shape, whether it's a spherical shape or it's a disc shape, and also the surface of the nuclei, whether it's a smooth surface or it's a rough surface, is a very important information for physicians to make a decision whether this is a normal cell or cancer cell. So earlier, when we use the machine learning, we really can segment out the nuclei from this 3D tomogram. But the only problem to using machine learning is that to generate this 3D nuclei segmentation, it took more than 24 hours. So it's really too long. So we try to see with the deep learning algorithm, whether we really can real time, once you acquire this kind of 3D imaging, you can immediately generate this kind of 3D segmentation. So the algorithm we apply is the so-called UNET. This is a very popular algorithm that people use for image segmentation. But the only difference is that in our case, because for the skin imaging, we care about some small feature like the nuclei. We also care about some large feature like the layer, for example, the DJ. So in our UNET, we try to add in the so-called deep feature shading so that when the UNET to train the network, it cares about both the small features like the nuclei and the larger features like the DJ. Okay, so this is the result using our clinical data. So for the nuclei, as you can see here, the IOU is the intersection over unit. So the accuracy is about 72%. For the layer structure, it's almost 90%. Okay, this is a quantitative assessment. And if you look at the qualitative result on the left column here, this is the input, the black and white OCT. The center column is the right column is the annotation by the physician. And the center column is the prediction by the convolutional neural network. You can see that either the nuclei or the layer structure, the prediction is quite similar to the physician's annotation. And once you have all this nuclei information, apparently you can do a lot of statistics, because for the nuclei within our skin, either the shape or the size is different, depends on the depths, okay? So at different depths from the stratum corneum, the ratio of the major and minor axis is different, apparently. So if you can real time generate this information so the physicians can make a diagnosis just immediately during the clinics. Okay, so these are our recent work on how we apply the deep learning on the OCT imaging. Now, in the future, I think our major work is try to, remember I mentioned about the virtual biopsy, okay? So here I say toward means not yet, okay? This is something our present work. We hope that we can faithfully translate the OCT black and white imaging into a colorful HE stain imaging. Because remember I mentioned for cancer diagnosis, using this kind of HE stain imaging, this is the gold standard. The OCT, this is a black and white. So we try to translate this imaging into this something like the HE stain imaging. And the good thing is that right now in the AI community, it's very popular that many smart people, they generate many algorithms. You can translate imaging, for example, from one style of painting to another style of painting. Or for a photo, you translate imaging from a winter photo to a spring or summer photo, okay? So you can see the result is quite impressive. But the only thing is that for this type of kind of artwork, you translate the painting style or you translate the photo from winter to summer, you don't quite care about accuracy, right? This is kind of art. But if you want to translate the OCT into a HE stain, you know, you got to have a very high accuracy. If the accuracy is low, you can imagine you may cause people's life, okay? So for this kind of translation, we try to not just count on the AI algorithm, we also count on physician's knowledge. So we try to add in physician's knowledge in our model. Because remember, right now, we can starting from, for example, the larger feature, the dermal epidermal junction, or the strident corneum, or the small feature like the nuclei, the pigment like the melanin. So because many of our collaborated physicians, they can identify these features. So we hope that in case we try to translate the OCT into HE, at least this important feature can be correctly translated, okay? And in the future, for some other information, for example, the microcirculation, inflammatory cells, even the tumor boundary, in case we can have better segmentation result, then we can also add in this type of physician's knowledge so the image translation can be accurate. Okay, so this is one of the work we have done 2 years ago. We use a very famous image translation algorithm, which is called CycleGAN. Okay, so this slide is a little bit crowded, but if you look at the structure, it's quite simple. In the center part, okay, in the center part, this is the conventional CycleGAN. So basically, you have two data sets. One is the OCT, this is the OCT data set. And on the lower right-hand side here, right-hand side here, this is HE stain. So basically, you have two data set, okay, one OCT, one HE. And these two are actually not correlated, okay? They are not kind of paired imaging, okay? So the CycleGAN tells you that you can convert the OCT into a HE. Apparently, this is a fake HE. You just use some algorithm. But if you convert this HE back to OCT again, we call this a reconstructed OCT. So for a high quality conversion, at least this is a reconstructed OCT and this input OCT should be the same, right? So we call this a cycle consistency. Similarly for HE, if you convert HE to a converted OCT, this is a fake OCT, then convert the OCT to the reconstructed HE and this HE should be the same, okay? So this is quite a successful translation algorithm for the painting translation or for the photo translation. But in our case, we want to add in the physician's knowledge, okay? How we add in? So from this OCT, remember we can segment out the dermal epidermal junction and also can segment out the nuclei. So in case this translation from OCT to here is a accurate transition. So the DEJ extract from this HE and the DEJ from this OCT should be the same. That means so we build up the loss functions based on either the layer structure or the nuclei. Okay, so this is the way we're adding the physician's knowledge. Okay, so this is the result. So on the left column is the input black and white OCT, and the second, the right column is the translated HE. So as you can see here, for this translation, at least for the DEJ, which is the green curve for the right-hand side and the left-hand side and the right-hand side, that match quite well, all the DEJ and the strident corneum, and also for the nuclei, the OCT and the HE, they match quite well. But since within the OCT, actually, they are very rich in information, not just the nuclei, not just the DEJ. Actually, in a human body, there are many spatial cells. For example, the Merkel cells, the ganglion cell. For those very spatial cells, And even myself and many of our collaborative physicians, they cannot tell or they cannot discriminate those spatial cells. But for this translation, at least for the normal nuclei and the layer structure, we can have a faithful translation. This is a quantitative assessment. As you can see here, in general, for the DEJ error, it's only about 1 to 2 micrometer. And for the IOU, it's also, we can reach up to about 90%. So I think for this translation of the nuclei and the DEJ is quite successful. But the only problem is that for this algorithm, you need a lot of physicians' time because they got to try to segment the DEJ for you and segment the nuclei for you. But usually for physicians or clinicians, they are very busy, okay? So if you ask the physician, your collaborator, try to segment maybe 20 patients or 30 patients, they probably will be happy to do it for you. But if you tell him you have 1,000 or 10,000 imagings, you ask the physicians to do probably only Google, because you know Google have a lot of money. Huh? Maybe they can persuade the physicians to label for you. Okay, but for university study, it's really no way. So we are thinking about whether without the physician knowledge, can we do a reasonable translation so that it can serve as a pre-training. Then later on, we use a smaller amount of physicians' annotation. We can try to reduce the effort of the physician. So very recently, we try to develop an unsupervised image translation. Unsupervised means that we don't need help from any physicians. You can see here, the basic algorithm quite similar to the cycle gain structure. The only difference is that right now there's no any segmentation from physicians, but we try to add in some noise. Why we try to add in noise? For example, within the, again, we have two data sets. One data set is OCT from here. This is one input data set. Another one here, this is the input HE data set, okay? But because for the real OCT, there are many so-called speckle noise. This speckle noise actually is not related to your structure. It's just noise, okay? So, but for the computer network, you have no idea what is the speckle noise, what is not speckle noise. So we try to add in some white noise here. So we can kind of force the algorithm to ignore those speckle noise, okay? So just focus on the real signal, not focus on the speckle noise. So adding white noise to mitigate the OCT speckle noise. And after you got this converted HE or fake HE, you want to translate this back to the reconstructed OCT, we're also adding another white noise. This noise actually is quite famous for image translation. People call this, with this noise, you can defend the adversarial attack. Because for the HE stand to the OCT translation, actually there are more information here because this is the colorful imaging. This is a black and white. So you can imagine there are more information in the input, but there are less information in the output, okay? So this is a, this is a one-to-many kind of translation. So adding this kind of white noise can defend this so-called adversarial attack. And from this a real HE to convert to a fake OCT, we also adding noise because as you can see, it's very clear that the HE imaging actually is the image quality is very high. But usually for OCT, the image quality is low. So you have a very high quality imaging, you want to convert to a low quality imaging, okay? So we add in some noise, so try to confuse the network, okay? So we can stabilize the inverse translation from HE to OCT. And similarly, for the fake OCT translate to the HE, because the converted OCT, usually there are many unnecessary details, which is not true, is either from the speckle noise or from other system noise. So we want to add in a noise here so that the network will only focus on the true data, not those noise. So this is the preliminary result. As you can see from the OCT to HE, these are input OCT, these are the converted HE. So the even without the physician's knowledge, the result, I think, is reasonably well. So you can see that we can using this so-called SNR gain as a pre-training. After you pre-train, then the second stage, you can apply the physician's labeling with a small amount of labeling so to get a better result. And also for this technology, we can also translate the HE imaging back to the black and white OCT. The reason for this application, actually, this experiment was suggested by the physicians because they say that because within the OCT, for those spatial cell, we really have no idea how those spatial cell may present within the OCT. But those spatial cell is very easy to be identified in the HE. So in case we convert the HE back into OCT, we may be able to get an idea how those spatial cells or structure may look like in OCT, okay? So you can see we have a quantitative comparison with using our SNR gain compared to our other famous network. We use the FID and the KID. These two are very popular kind of metric people to compare with, to benchmark the image translation. So it seems to me our SNR gain really works. So either the FID or KID, either from OCT to HE or from HE to OCT, we have shows the best result. Yeah, very recently, our paper just got accepted by the computer method and programs in medicine. Okay, now, so it seems to me, I hope that I convince you that apply the AI on OCT is quite successful. But still, many people worry that, well, whether the AI is responsible, whether the AI is ethical, whether the AI really benefit people, because sometimes people worry about whether our human privacy was insulted because of AI, or whether your AI has a discrimination on different races, okay? So for this, either the AI, whether it's responsible or it's trustworthy, the core concept actually is about whether the AI is fair or whether the AI is explainable, okay? Whether the AI is fair, I think this issue actually is pretty complicated, but it can be solved by the IRB, because for any kind of clinical trial, you got to write a proposal, submit to the IRB. They need to review whether you care about the human privacy, whether you are fair to everybody, you are fair to the patient, to the physicians. Okay, so I think this issue can be solved by the IRB, but for the artificial network, it's really the technical people got to show people whether your AI is explainable. So these days, there are many tools being developed, try to show people why the AI works. So earlier I showed you about the bright spot, right? That's one way. That's called so-called Gradient. So you can find out where's the hotspot. Another very important tool is the so-called sharp, okay? The sharp is a kind of concept to let you know, because if you apply AI on the OCT, the diagnosis result may be correct, may be incorrect, okay? So the sharp can tell you when the result is correct, why the result is correct, when the result is wrong, why it's wrong, okay? So to do this, so we try to use a conventional machine learning technique. We try to extract many important features, okay? Because from this OCT imaging, there are many features that we can identify. For example, what's the size of the nuclei? What's the standard deviation of these nuclei sizes? What's the length of the DEJ, okay? So you can imagine many different features, okay, can be extracted from the OCT. And we can try to correlate how important each of these features, whether they are important to the diagnosis of this disease and other disease. So you can imagine different diseases needs has high correlation with different parameters. Our goal is for skin cancer, but the issue is that right now in Taiwan, after 2 years, I think the number of patients we collect is less than 10 patients. So it's really not a big data, right? But for eczema, it's something in Taiwan, for some reason, we have a lot of patients. They have eczema. So we use, I think for this one, we have maybe 70 or 80, remember total data set is about 200 patients. I think for eczema, we have about 70 to 80 patients. Okay, so this is a kind of big data. Okay, So from our, we try to have 8 different features. So to diagnose whether the imaging is from an eczema patient, the most important feature is the thickness of the epithelium, okay? And the second importance is the nuclear area, the standard deviation, the size deviation of the nuclei, and other features are not that important, okay? So let me show you here. We have 4 imagings from different eczema patients. The first 3, the AI give a correct diagnosis. The AI results show that these 3 are from eczema. So you can see here, well, really, it shows that the epithelium is very thick, okay? So this is a very important that why the AI diagnosed these 3 as a correct eczema is because they have a very thick epithelium layer, okay? For the fourth one, the diagnosis is wrong. And why is wrong? Because the AI misdiagnosed the thickness of the epithelium layer. That's why the result is wrong. So using this sharp tool, so people can have more idea how the AI make a decision, whether they really extract those information. With this, I think I would like to conclude my talk. So I hope that I can, you are convinced that cellular resolution OCT can really reveal the tiny nuclei structure or the layer structure. And using the deep learning, you can segment those the nuclei and the layer structure, or you can translate the imagings. In the future, I think using the deep learning technology, it's not just powerful, which can give you a quite high accuracy. Also, it's explainable so that people really can trust this kind of technology. Okay, so with this, I think I should acknowledge my collaborators on the OCT light sources and on the AI. So because in Taiwan, we have a AI center funded by our government, and to do the clinical trial, you do have need an instrument. And these are my hospital collaborators. Yeah, I think so. Thank you for your attention. Yeah, any questions are welcome. Yeah. Oh.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Huang. It was really spectacular. I mean, scintillating talk, I must say, the way you can really connect up essentially AI-related technologies to real working medical applications. Mm-hmm. And they are products. I mean, they're products that are used, and you can really see the sensitivities to be, close to 90-95%. An amazing kind of work. And we all would like to congratulate you and your teams, collaborators, for doing such a splendid work. And we also wish great luck for future endeavors as well. So with that, let me take if there are any questions from the audience right here. Also, those of you who are on the Zoom and YouTube, you may also type in or ask questions. Please unmute yourself and ask questions from those who are on Zoom. Yeah, first, any questions from here on the... Yeah, there's one. I see a question here in the middle.
Yeah, first for the Shapley values that you were talking about, sharp that you were using, mm-hmm. Is it always explainable? I mean, is it always able to explain the features for CNN that you showed, or is there ambiguity in that?
That's a good question. Because right now, when people use sharp, there are many different ways people can apply sharp. But in our case, we try to use the machine learning, we extract features to use the sharp. But the one thing I need to emphasize is that the purpose of sharp is try to explain, but it doesn't mean that when you apply an algorithm, you will try to explain the result. But actually then in that case, the accuracy of that algorithm actually is kind of degraded. So we found that, so for some algorithm, you can have very good accuracy, but it's not quite explainable. But using sharp is something you can explain your result, but the accuracy may not be the highest. Yeah, and also there are many different approaches people apply sharp, yeah.
So it depends on the context.
Mm-hmm.
Also for the UNET, can you please go to the slide for UNET?
I mean the UNET.
So I was confused in the sense that it's a three-dimensional data, right? Because you're also mapping the data.
Okay, this is a good question.
So how are you segmenting it, and how do you use that skip connection that you're using over there? So how do you choose which part to basically? So firstly, how are you segmenting it into two dimensions?
Because for our 3D, right now we are trying two type of unit. In this case, this is a 2D unit. Okay, the reason we start from 2D unit earlier is because the computation power. Okay, if you want to do 3D unit, because recently in Taiwan we have a national high computation center. We try to adding with a better GPU and larger memory. So very recently we are able to do 3D unit. For this result, it's based on 2D. So for this 3D volume, so for each of the 2D slides, we apply this this 2D unit. Okay. So actually, for the concatenation, this is a quite conventional way people do this. The major difference is that we try to adding this this deep feature sharing. Okay. So so the result can have a balanced opinion based on either the small feature and the larger feature. Because usually for the conventional unit, the result is mainly based on the final layer here, okay? But right now we have a kind of a deep supervision. We use the last three layer, kind of build out a loss function. So can it seems to us it can slightly improve the segmentation accuracy.
How do you choose which layer to choose to share the deep feature from?
I think all the layers here, we have a concatenation layer here. The issue actually is that because for unit, you could have many different layers, because for each layer, the receptive field is different, okay? So when you design the unit, you got to base on what's the feature size you're looking for. For example, for nuclei, we know that typically the nuclei size is about 5 micrometer or something like that. So when we try to do the we have many downsampling layers. We got the choice whether it's a 2x2 or 3x3 kind of downsampling. Yeah, those things are what we design. But for other concatenation, I think this is quite just a normal unit structure. Yeah, we don't design the unit start from scratch. We actually just download the conventional unit, then we try to modify.
Based on your requirements.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for a very enlightening talk. It's amazing to see how you can achieve, histopathological resolution with your OCT images. I'm just wondering whether this is limited to OCT alone, or will such techniques help other radiological things, x-rays, for example, x-ray imaging? Can you use the similar kind of AI, despeckling, whatever it is, these algorithms to make sense of images that are more widely available and accessible? I mean, how many places will have access to an OCT kind of an imaging system? There are much more places, commonly available imaging systems. Can we use such techniques to extract even more information out of simple black and white images?
Actually, right now for biomedical imaging technology, you heard about many different ones. For example, the confocal, you have a super resolution, many different kinds. But the issue is that we prefer to start from OCT because the advantage of OCT, first of all, it is high speed. Okay. Secondly, it's a high resolution. Thirdly, it's safe. You can do in vivo. Many technology, for example, X-ray can give you a very high resolution, but you got to slice the sample, to froze the sample, right? So I think the good thing for OCT is that it has better chance to be used in a clinical setting, kind of point of care situation. So in terms of spatial resolution, OCT is not the best, okay? But if you talk about the possibility for clinical diagnosis, OCT has the highest chance. That's why we start from OCT. And there are other biomedical technology, for example, confocal. Confocal also can be applied for in vivo. But the issue for confocal is that usually the penetration depth is too shallow. Yeah, I talked to some of the physicians working on confocal microscopy. The deepest tissue penetration is about maybe 200 micron. It's a little bit shallower, but OCD is just deeper. Yeah, and some people ask me about well, your OCD may have enough resolution compared to the pathology. It's comparable, but for the pathology, those stain imaging, they have two color. That means they have more information. Your OCT, you only have a black and white. Even though the resolution is the same, how can you translate the OCT with less information to an HE stain with more information? Actually, you know, for OCT, it has a high resolution. Actually, it's in all the three dimensions, the X, Y, Z. It all has maybe 1 micrometer resolution. But for the HE stain imaging, on the planar in the view, 2D image is a high resolution. But for each of the HE stain, actually, you have a thickness. Yeah. The thickness actually maybe is about 4 to 10 micron. But OCT is 1 micron. So in a sense, OCT has more information. Yeah. So in terms of information wise, OCT and the HE stain, each have its own advantage. One has more color, one has more fine details. Yeah. I don't know whether that answers your question. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It was very nicely explained again, Dr. Huang. So on behalf of the asset colloquium and also the IEEE Bombay Section Photonics Society, we'd like to present you with a memento. This forum that you are talking today has completed 40 years this year. Mm-hmm. So we have designed a special memento for it. So we'd like to accept a memento from us.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much. And we have today the tea and snack in the auditorium cafeteria. So we request all of you to join. Thank you very much once again for joining and making this very useful discussions. Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tadasaya.
So, okay, let me close the.